Good evening. We just want to welcome you here tonight. If you want to stand, we invite you to do that. We're going to sing as we just look to Jesus tonight.
I forgot my water bottle.
Here we go.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way for let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life be led. Dash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my fear rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, it's your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame is a ransom paid for me before. You canceled my debt and you called me his friend. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh yes, it's your grace, so free, washes over me.
hope. You've given us restoration. Lord, you've cleansed us from all of our sin, all of the things that held us back from relationship with you. God, you wash them away. God, we choose you tonight. God, I pray that you would be our heart, that you would be our focus, Lord, as we go throughout all this night. Not only this night, but every day of our lives, God, that we would put you at the forefront of our heart and our mind. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
We just want to say thank you so much for joining us tonight at the Orchards Church. We're excited that you're here. We had some really cool testimonies this week, so we just want to say thank you for praying. Thank you for joining in our prayers. I got a good report from the doctor, benign tumor, no cancer, yay! And we also had another couple in our church who's been looking for a house forever, and everything kept just falling through. This week, they finally got the go-ahead to buy a house, and so they're rejoicing, their family's rejoicing, their tiny apartment is being left, so we're excited for them. But thank you for praying with us. We rejoice with those who rejoice and mourn with those who mourn. Amen?
So my name is Todd, and this is Angela, and we are part of the Orchards Church here in Lander, Wyoming. And we just encourage you to join us on social media, whether that's Instagram or Facebook, but specifically, we encourage you to go to the Bible app, and on the bottom of the Bible app, and under the More tab, there's a section called Events, and if you could go under that, you can see all of the notes from today, all the scriptures that we're going to use, all the songs that we are singing today. Those are right there at your fingertips, as well as the group questions, the growth time questions that we have, and you can just ask yourself those questions. But I encourage you more to ask somebody else those questions, just to get some feedback. And so that's that. We just want to again say thank you, especially whether you're online or here in person, for your faithful giving. Just this past week, we had a church call us up and say, "Hey, we know that at the end of our year, we had some extra funds, and so we just wanted to bless the Orchards Church, and we were able to buy a baptistry as opposed to I guess it's not a baptistry, it's more of a hot tub, but we're using it as a baptistry just a couple weeks.
Or will we? No.
versus a trough, yeah. Which, I don't know, maybe that's scriptural, because Jesus, yeah. I don't know,
whatever.
We have a baptistry, and so it's heated, and so if you're interested in getting baptized, we encourage you to do that. We'll be doing that on January 31st, and so that's going to be just an awesome time to gather. We're going to join with our kids tonight, and we're going to do our kids' song as we look at our message today. We have a dream to grow, and so this song goes right along with that.
Verse, and I'm like, yikes, Paul, okay, calm down, brother. Don't need to rebuke that hard. The next verse kind of describes what this infant Peter Pan Christian looked like in Paul's opinion and in reality, because he says, "For you are still controlled by your sinful nature. You are jealous of one another and quarrel with each other. Doesn't that prove that you're controlled by your sinful nature? Aren't you living like people of the world?" And he's juxtaposing those people of the world versus people who are Christ followers, people of the church who should know better, who should stop being infants and start growing up. And he describes this worldly behavior in many of his epistles. Paul wrote 13 books of the Bible, and in each one of them, he's sort of giving feedback or giving advice to what he sees as problem places in the churches, and then he tells them about it. But the key is that he's talking about churches. He's not talking about pre-Christians or those who are don't know the Lord yet. He's talking about those of us who are in the church, who have accepted Christ. He's saying, you guys need to kind of get it together. This is a bit of a hard message today, so I'm just going to ask you real quick to pick up your toes off the floor so that I don't step on them, and then I won't feel bad. But our big idea for today is we have a dream to grow. As a church, one of our core visions, one of our core statements that we espouse and we say every week is that each person that comes to the church or is associated or is on Facebook with us, we want you to grow in spiritual maturity, not staying infants in Christ. Growth signifies life. Growth signifies health. If my children stopped growing, I wouldn't say, oh, that's too bad for them. No, I would take them to the doctor. I would see what was wrong with them. We don't want seedlings that wither and die on the vine. We want to see them thrive. We want to see growth in our plants. We want to grow and produce fruit. And so today we want to look at the how can we grow and why do we want to grow? Because we have a dream to grow.
So we're going to start with how do we grow. So last week we talked about the Great Commission to tell other people about Jesus. So let's read that again in Matthew 28, verse 19. He says, "Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." See, he says here, make disciples. Plant. Tell. But then, when the seed sprouts, we need to make disciples. A disciple, what is a disciple? It's a learner, a follower, a grower, a thriving being when it's related to the church. So how do we do that? And the short answer is, we pray, we read the Bible, we go to church, we become a lifelong follower of Jesus Christ. And my experience has been, it's got to go deeper than that. Because you can know a ton of scripture, but it not be impacting your life. You could know what it means to pray, but never actually have a prayer life, have a prayer commitment to God. You can do a lot of the things, the religious things. You can go to church. It does not make you a Christ follower. So what does it mean to be a Christ follower? The actual answer is it takes effort and execution of the task. And this is far from easy. I mean, anyone who's walked with Jesus for a decent amount of time can tell you that. It takes daily discipline and a lifelong commitment. It's hard. Adulting, even as a Christ follower, is hard. So today we're going to talk about some verses and what it takes to commit to growing in our relationship with Jesus. So I want you to join me as we look. We have several scriptures, and so I encourage you to take out the Bible app and to go to the events page and look us up, because there's all those scriptures are right there. We're going to start with Matthew 28, verse 20. And it says this: "Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you." Now, that seems pretty simple, okay? Obey all the commands. That would make sense. If you want to be a follower, do what your teacher tells you to do, right? John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35 say this: "Now I'm giving you a new commandment. Love each other, just as I have loved you. You should love one another. Your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples." Love. That's a nice one. It's a pretty one. We talk about it. Even the world talks about what it means to love. It sounds great. We can do that. We can love. John chapter 8, verses 31 and 32 says this: "Jesus said to the people who believed in him, 'You are truly my disciples if you remain faithful to my teachings, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free.'" We like freedom, right? We don't want to be bound. We don't want to be held back. We can stay faithful, and we can live in freedom. That's a great thing. Now let's go to Luke chapter 14, verse 33. It says this: "So you cannot become my disciple without giving up everything you own." Okay, so now we're getting a little deeper. Now that's stepping on some toes, right? It's a little harder. That's a little more on the adulting side of what it means to be a follower of Jesus. Let's look at Luke chapter 9, verse 23. It says, "Then he said to the crowd, 'If any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way, take up your cross daily, and follow me.'" Okay, sure, let's do that. It's starting to get more difficult, isn't it? Luke 14, verse 26. "If you want to be my disciple, here's what you have to do. You must, by comparison, hate everything else: your father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even your own life. Otherwise, you cannot be my disciple." Oh man, that's pretty rough. What does that look like? What does that mean? Stop stepping on my toes, Jesus. Stop messing with me. I'm not ready to go that deep yet. That's what adulting is. Galatians chapter 5, verse 24. "Those who belong to Christ Jesus have nailed their passions and desires of their sinful nature to the cross and crucified them there." Oh man. Now we're really taking on some attributes of Jesus. And then it's getting thick in here. It's getting hard in here. Colossians chapter 3, verse 5 through 9. "So put to death the sinful, earthly things lurking within you. Have nothing to do with sexual immorality, impurity, lust, and evil desires. Don't be greedy, for a greedy person is an idolater, worshiping the things of this world. Because of these sins, the anger of God is coming." Verse 7. "You used to do these things when your life was still part of this world. But now is the time to get rid of anger, rage, malice behavior, slander, and dirty language. Don't lie to each other, for you have stripped off your old sinful nature and all its wicked deeds." Wow. Now that's a list. And oftentimes as a church, we kind of cling to these, don't we? Don't do this. Don't do this. Don't do this. Don't do this. And the reality is, that's what Jesus is saying. And that's just a few of the verses that talk about what it looks like to be a disciple. No wonder we don't want to grow up, right? Like, it sounds like pain. It really sounds like any teenager would tell you, man, growing pains hurt. It's painful. Like, stiffness in your legs and your joints and those kind of things. But it doesn't mean we stop growing. We have to keep on going. Because oftentimes the pain of growth creates a stronger, more complete you, which is always worth the effort. We say it all the time, right? No pain, no gain. Just because something is hard doesn't mean it's not worth the effort. You see, becoming a new creation, dying to self, picking up the cross of Christ, that's growing. Committing to a lifelong journey to begin to become a disciple of Christ. I have to tell you, it's probably the toughest thing that you'll ever do. But it's also the most rewarding. Is it demanding? Absolutely. But the journey is amazing if you'll choose it. You see, it takes all the discipline you have to give and for a lifetime. And the encouragement is, it's God's power within you. That's how to grow as a disciple of Jesus.
So it it kind of leads us to why. Why would we put forth all this effort? Dot just said it was hard, it was painful, there was a big list of things that we can't do. Why in the world would we do this? Why would we take this all this effort to grow? And this is where it gets a little deeper, because I think for the most part, we like to talk about the good stuff of God. And there's so much, right? There's so much good. Todd was saying, you know, don't do this. You know, it's legalism, it's grace, and it's mercy. Come on, get on board with that. And for the most part, that is the way that it is. We want to take all of his favor and all of his grace and all of his mercy, and he lavishes on us so much of that. And even when we mess up, even if we do fall into one of these lists, you know, he's going to give us grace and mercy. But the truth is that the part of adulting that we don't like in our physical life is the same kind of adulting that causes us to grow in Christ. The part of God that we don't like to talk about is the part that he keeps us accountable. He knows. He sees. He sees what we do, and he has an idea for us and where we should go. And I think the part of adulting that I like the least is when I have to be held accountable. When the buck stops with me. If you're a manager, if you're and any kind of, well, if you're in any kind of job, there's going to be a time where it's your fault if this doesn't work out. It's your head that's going to roll if this all goes south. It's a part of being adults that no one really cares for because it's hard. And when we look at the things of Christ, when we look at adulting as Christ followers, we like to talk about God's grace and we like to talk about his forgiveness, but when we start to grow, when we become mature in Christ, then we also like to talk about his justice. And we also like to talk about his fairness and his accountability and his future to judge us and reward us based on the things we did. I know it got really quiet in here because nobody likes to talk about this part. You see, like it or not, the why of growth is based on, yes, our love for God, yes, our longing to do what he has called us to do, our relationship with him, and all of the good things. But it is also based on our culpability. We are responsible for the growth and the decisions that we make as Christ followers. We read the many lists of things that God wants us to do and all the many lists of what it takes to be disciples. And these are not just suggestions. He's not saying, it'd be great if you could stop that. That'd be awesome. No, he wants you to do that. He wants you to take on his ideas and his lifestyles so that we would abide in him and see growth in our lives. And the Bible says, I love this verse in the Bible, that there's going to be a day when our decisions and our choices will be called into account. 2 Corinthians 5:10 says it this way, for we must all stand before Christ to be judged. Christ is our judge. Let me just clarify that. We will each receive whatever we deserve for the good or the evil that we have done in this earthly body. Please let me be clear on this. This has nothing to do with salvation. This is not about whether or not you can be saved, that you have to go through this laundry list of things. You're saved by grace through faith, and this is nothing you can do. It's a gift from God. However, once you do make this decision, once you are growing in Christ, those who call on Jesus and will live in heaven forever, there's going to be a time when he's going to bring you before him and say, okay, what choices did you make? And what Paul is describing here is the judgment of Christ followers who are guaranteed heaven. I just want to make that, this is a guarantee, but what he's going to ask is, what did you do with the life that I gave you? And this is not going to be a sense of condemnation, although there will be a little bit of loss, the Bible says. But it's going to be a judgment of reward and accountability. And I think this is tough for us because we think of judgment as bad and offensive. Don't judge me, or I'm not going to have the gavel and all that kind of stuff. But accountability isn't all negative. It's a good thing, actually. It can be comforting to know that God sees everything that you do, all the hard work that you put in that nobody else sees, that nobody else gives you credit for. God sees that. He sees all the sacrifices that you've made. He sees the tears and the sleepless nights, and he will on that day say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into your rest and this sweet, sweet house that I've made for you. But it will also be, why didn't you do this? Why didn't you take the time to reach out to that person? Why didn't you seize that opportunity that I gave you? Paul uses the analogy of a building when he describes this process. In 1 Corinthians 3:12 through 15, he says, anyone who builds on that foundation, so salvation is that foundation, God gave us that, may use a variety of materials, gold, silver, jewels, wood, hay, straw, but on judgment day, fire will reveal what kind of work each builder has done. The fire will show if a person's work has any value. If the work survives, that builder will receive a reward. But if that work is burned up, then that builder will suffer great loss. And the builder will be saved, but like someone barely escaping through a wall of flames. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to just barely make it. I don't want to get a D in my Christian walk and say, well, at least I passed. I don't want to barely squeak by. I want to grow and have life and have it to the full. I want to learn and study Christ. I want to grow closer to him, and I want to know more of him, and I want him to fill me up every single day. I want to lead others to get to know him. I want to be loving hands and feet of Christ to those who need loving hands and feet. I want to live as far away from that line of sin as I can and not see how close I can get to it without being burned, literally. So that when I stand before Christ and he sees all the things, I say, good job, and because what you did for the least of those, you did for me. And all those sacrifices were totally worth it. judges so fairly that he'll read through false motives. He'll read through selfish ideals. He knows the difference and he sees the heart. So we want to be able to genuinely honor and love him with our actions, with how we live our life, with the words we say, with the things we think, with the lifestyle we lead. We want to genuinely love and honor God, and that's why we have a dream to grow. Thankfully, since growing up is so hard, and Peter Pan would be so much easier, not better, just easier. But it's why God said, you know what, I'm going to send my church to work together to make that dream grow. I'm gonna have a church that relies on one another and can lift each other up. It's why we as the Orchard Church say all the time, people growing together producing fruit. Not that we've already arrived, not that we're so cool, no way, we're right in the thick of it. But we want to be a place where we can encourage and we can help. And if you're having a bad day, I can lift you up. And if I'm having a bad day, you can lift me up. And we can hold each other accountable and we can sharpen each other. And we can love each other unconditionally. We want to be a part of your growing to become a thriving, healthy, strong, contributing member of the family of God. A strong and healthy orchard, not just for Todd and Angela's sake or the Orchard's Church sake, but that each one of us can hear those words, well done. Growth is hard, but together as a church, together as a body of believers, and I say church universal, not just here, together we can do it. Together we can see the dream of growth come true. Will you bow your heads and close your eyes with me? I don't know where you are in your journey toward Christ, with Christ, however you want to say it. Maybe you haven't made that step yet and you're like, whoa, Ange, that is heavy. Believe me when I tell you, God doesn't expect you to clean up before you come to him. He just says, come. For the rest of us who have made that decision, God's not asking for perfection. He's asking for your trying. Yes, we're going to fall. Yes, we're going to fail. But together we're going to pick one another up, help each other. His Holy Spirit is going to be working inside of us each step of the way, guiding us, helping us, directing us so that we can grow. Father, I thank you so much for the great vision that you have, the dream that you have for us. And you dream and you desire for us to be healthy and living and thriving and growing and contributing. People, children of you, help us, God, to take that on, not as a burden, not as some heavy load, not as, oh, I don't think I can do it, but as a dream that says, yes, I'll pursue that. Yes, I'm going to keep striving. I'm going to keep trying. If I mess up 100 times, then I'm going to keep going, because we love you so much, God. We want to faithfully serve you with everything that we are. Help me, Jesus, in all of the things that I fail, in all of my shortcomings, God. Help me, Lord, to get back up and to try again and to know that your grace is there. Your mercy is there. Help us, Lord, to do everything we can to honor you. In your name, God, we pray. Amen.
tasted the world to more than enough. Its promise is fleeting. Water and wine, I've emptied the cup and found myself wanting. There is a well that never runs dry.
Yes.
The water of life, the blood of vine. And all I know is everything I have means nothing. Jesus, if you're not my one thing, everything I need right now. Oh, I need you right now. Oh, I need you, Lord.
Yes, God.
Just one thing I ask, and this I will see.
Yes. Thank you.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Yes, we live for you. Holy, there is no one. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever breathe. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. We sing, holy, there is no one like. Open up my eyes in wonder. You show me.
get into our Grove time, don't forget about our baptism celebration on January 31st, and that is going to be a kids' service for us as well since it's a fifth Sunday. Starting next week, we're going to encourage you to fast as we go into that fifth Sunday, where we like to take 4 weeks a year and fast and pray, so we'll be giving you some more information about that next week. And then, that was weird. Okay, and then don't forget that next week we're going to be encouraging you to write down those dreams that God has been placing on your heart this month. And maybe some of those were sparked today. Lord, help me in my devotion life. Help me in my prayer life. Help me to grow in you and not to stay where I've been, but to pursue more of you and to be full of you and filled up more with you. And not that we could ever do that on our own. Like Todd said, it's completely with the power of the Holy Spirit working inside of us and working together as a church to grow and to pursue more of him. We are going to have a special celebration on February 7th. We call it a business meeting. We're trying not to think of it as a business meeting, but we do have to go over some of the finances of the church. Our superintendent is going to be here and he's going to share with us. And we're going to celebrate just some of the things that God has done for us as a church over the past year. God has blessed and he's kind of blown us away with some of the things that he's been doing, even in the midst of a pandemic, even though it's been the craziest year ever. God has still been good to us, so we're going to talk about those things. We invite you to the 4 o'clock service on that day. He's going to be here in that evening service, so I think that's all I had. Are you good?
I did want to say, if you are a guest with us tonight, if you want to fill out that guest card, or you can just comment or direct message us or email us at info@theorchards.church and just get a hold of us. We'd love to hear your praise reports. We'd love to pray with you. I know we've had several needs this week. Some friends of ours that have kind of taken us under their wing. They're in the midst of just a separation, and we're just going to just continue to pray for them, as well as Angela's grandparents are hopefully getting on the far side of COVID, and so just be praying for them. And so many needs that we, that whether they're spoken or unspoken, the amazing thing is God knows all of them. And so I just encourage you just to lift those up. But if you want to let us know, we can join with you specifically in prayer. And then when God does do something in your life, we just want to hear about it, we want to celebrate it, and we want to share it with all of God's family. And so let's pray, and then we'll go into our Grove time. Father, we just come before you today. God, we thank you, Lord, that you, yes, you've laid out this growth pattern for us. Yes, you've laid out a plan of discipleship and becoming a learner and a follower of Jesus. And at the same time, Lord, you said, I'm willing to help you. I send the Holy Spirit to be your comfort, to be your help, to be your paraclete, the one that comes alongside and encourages you, that reminds you. But Lord, I pray that we would make that decision. Lord, that we would make the choice to just move past those worldly things into that holiness that you desire from us. God, I pray that you would help us. Lord, be with us. Lord, wherever anyone is tonight, God, I pray that you would strengthen them. Lord, I pray for the needs that are represented. Be with those as well. God, do the work that only you can do. God, we give you praise and honor and glory. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. We're going to get into our Grove time, and you can check those out on the Bible app. God bless you.